number one fishing port in America. New Bedford, Massachusetts. Welcome to the Paul Santos Live Show. Tonight's guests are amazing singer Emily Naraki, we have comic Grace Whitestone here, actor Michael Hopkins, and we've got the PSL band, Gary Langevin and Artie DeMello.
Thank you, everybody. Thanks, Allison.
And me, I'm Allison Dian. Hello, and thank you for watching. And now, ladies and gentlemen, the host of our show, Paul Santos!
Wow. Welcome to our little show. Wow, what a crowd we got here tonight. Are you feeling good tonight? Wow, my ears. Gary, Artie, what's up?
What's happening, babe? A little different with a full house, right?
That's right, full house. And look who's back, Allison Dian. Hey, Allison!
So glad to be back.
We missed you.
I missed you, too.
Well, we're so glad to have you looking in here tonight. If you're watching on ABC6 in Providence, good Sunday morning to you. If you're watching into Bedford, Dartmouth, Fairhaven, and Acushnet, good evening. And if you're watching our live stream, I want you to type something in. Say hello. A little interactive, you know? Let the fingers do the walking like Allison's doing over there, right? It's like that. Let the fingers do the walking. So say hello and give us some positive feedback. As you know, we highlight the talented, the interesting, and the entertaining from our area. But first, got to get caught up in the news. Ready to get caught
up in
the news?
Oh, yeah, let's do it.
All right. Well, here's the big news item right now that's all over the news. Bill Belichick, 71 years old, is dating a 24-year-old former cheerleader. Did you see that? Oh, my God. Wow. Remember when he was coaching young talent? Now he's dating it. I gotta tell you, I saw the picture of the girl. She's a first-round pick. I'll tell you, that age difference, I mean, it's big. It's really big.
How big is it, Paul?
I'll tell you, on date night, he has to call in the special teams.
She didn't even sign the contract yet, and she was already MVP.
Hey! I've heard of a center plunge, but not like that. Hey! You know, the Beatles have that song, Can't Buy Me Love. Yes, you can.
Damn.
Hey, you know, maybe we're being wise guys, you know. I mean, maybe it's just that Bill has, a big heart.
I'm sure he's got a big bulge in his back pocket.
The back pocket?
That's where you keep the wallet, right?
Back pocket,
come on.
One thing you
don't
have to worry about in this relationship, there will be no Deflategate in this
one. That's right, no Deflategate. <yeah. laughs> Hey, you know, I'm looking out here, we're having some great weather. Isn't this weather fantastic here in New England now? Yeah. There is one little downside, a lot of pollen out there, you know? Yeah. So I know people are getting a lot of allergies and stuff like that. Hey, wait a minute. Allergies. Hmm. That reminds me of one of Artie's ex-girlfriends. Well, it could be that one. Yeah. Paul and Mary. Oh. Yeah, you know from Peter, Paul and Mary. Hey, you know where she's now?
Yeah.
She's in California blowing in the wind.
California Dreaming?
You know, there was a second layer to that joke, but we'll just kind of let it sit there.
Yeah.
We'll just kind of let it sit there. They call that letting the joke land, you know? Allison's right there.
Well, you know, on the same page, Paul.
There is some controversy in Providence, you know. 500 Providence students, it has been determined, need urgent dental care. Imagine that. So these are like elementary kids.
Already?
So they sent them to the dentist, right? And the dentist was like an older guy. There was an elementary student sitting there. So the old dentist said, young man, I'm sorry to tell you this. but you have plaque. The kid said, yeah, I won in Little League.
Oh.
No, you have tartar. No, I put that on fish.
Oh.
Tell the teacher you have an abscess. No, she took it away. I was bad.
Oh.
Son, I've got one more thing to tell you. I'm sorry, you have a cavity. I might have to use the drill. The kid said, no, that's when the teacher visits the janitor. All right, that's a 50-50. That's a 50-50. That's a 50-50. Hey, did you hear about Ben Affleck and J-Lo? That marriage is on the rocks already. Can you believe that?
I didn't know you were married.
Yeah, no, they got married, and now it's already on the rocks. I mean, I thought that hot booty might hold it together, you know? You know, it's actually helped to my wife and I. You know, I have a hot booty. Did you know that, Gary?
I did, yeah.
Yeah, that's one of my favorite.
Was it a booty or cootie?
No, no, Gary. I know, Gary, you want to see it, but I'm sorry, you can't.
No, please don't flatter yourself, sweetheart.
Come on, I got one of those round Portuguese ones, you know?
Yeah, that's what they call it in Portuguese, okay? That's
what we call it in pow, pow.
We call it flabby vavoo.
Not yet. Anyway, let's move on here. Hey, speaking of entertainers, you know Ryan Gosling and Mikey Day? They did a skit on Saturday Night Live doing that famous cartoon Beavis and Butthead. Oh, speaking of Butthead, Casey's here tonight. Hey, Casey.
Oh, yeah.
Hey, you know, Casey won some money on a scratch ticket. Did you hear that? Yeah, he forgot that he had these jeans, and he put these jeans on, and he was sitting on the couch, and he kind of dozed off, and he was falling asleep, and then he started scratching himself, and then he pulled it out. He's like, I won! Come on, that was a damn good joke.
That was great.
All right, while we're on the subject of scratching yourself, my dog, right? My dog, Stanley.
Stanley's the best. Stanley's the best.
I got this little dog, Stanley, a little Havanese, you know. So he's kind of strange, you know. He has this stuffed animal bunny. And I'm sorry to say this. I know people are trying to have dinner and everything. But a lot of times he humps the bunny.
Oh,
you know what I'm
awesome.
Saying? Now, I know what you're thinking. You're thinking, well, you know, it's a dog. That's a natural thing. But we had the dog neutered a long time ago.
Yeah.
He was fixed a long time ago. So why is he still doing that? You know, there's something in that male brain. You know, you just can't shut it off. Right, Allison?
Exactly. He's still got the urge.
But anyway, we discovered something, right? He only humps that bunny when he's scared. And I got to tell you, I'm scared right now. So look out. Ah! I'm sorry. This monologue is unwinding fast, isn't it?
Yeah.
It's unwinding fast. Well, you know. Don't be afraid. Don't be afraid, because we have hit a crescendo.
Oh,
we have hit the climax. I'm sorry to tell you this, but I'm going to have to deliver to you the final joke of the night.
The final joke.
Wow.
Hey, Aaron, did you just turn up the speakers just then? What the heck happened there?
Take it away, Paul.
He just turned it up just then. That's what happened. He turned it down before. You know, that's what happened. Anyway. No. This is actually a true story. I know you guys are thinking I'm going in the gutter with the monologue here. But in downtown New Bedford, they are building a giant rooster. They're building a giant rooster, and they're going to put it right in downtown New Bedford. It's a famous artist. He's going to put it right there in downtown New Bedford. Can you imagine that? So picture this. You know, I work in downtown New Bedford. You get in your car. You drive down Route 195. You turn on to Route 18 into downtown New Bedford. You come around that curve. You pull into the number one fishing port in America. And there you hear it. Out in the distance, you hear New Bedford's giant cock crowing.
Yeah. I mean, cock-a-doodle-doo.
A dream come true, I'll tell you. I mean, it's going to be big. Welcome to New Bedford, cock-a-doodle-doo. It could be worse. It could be in Fall River. Cock-a-doodle-doo. Watch out for the potholes. Cock-a-doodle-doo. South Coast Rail is coming, I promise. Cock-a-doodle-doo. All right. We have a big show tonight. Is everybody feeling good or what? All right. All right. We have a great show for you tonight. We'd first like to thank our sponsors, the place that actually lets us come here every Monday night. They still going to let us come here after that? Yeah, we're okay. We're good, right? Mikey B's, ladies and gentlemen, Mikey B's. All right. I'd like to thank my good friend, attorney John B. Seed. Cisco, New Bedford, Alden Court, ServPro, Dartmouth, New Bedford, the CEO of a great comedy club, and she is doing fantastic. It's the CEO is Allison Dyan. It's Dyan for Laughs! We missed that little thing that you do there, you know. We like that little thing that you do. And last but not least, you finally got those wires all plugged in. This is a documentary film producer, award-winning, Mr. Aaron Kadju.
So, Paul, there's a problem with pediatric dentistry in Rhode Island, in Providence. Yeah. Is the person in charge of that also in charge of the Washington Bridge?
Yeah, that's right. Yeah, probably, I'll tell you. We got a lot of problems. Washington Bridge and all kind of problems. But we'll solve them. We're going to solve them all right here, right, Gary? All right, we have a great show lined up for you. Our first guest, you absolutely love her. We love her so much, we asked her to come back, and she came. She came
Yay!
Back. Emily Naraki is up next. It's the Paul Santos Live Show. Thank you so much for looking in. We'll be right back. In the meantime, Gary Arty, the best band in all the land, the PSL Band! All right, once again, let's hear it. By Gary Landrum and Artie DeMello, the PSL Band. How about those guys,
Thank
huh?
Thank you, everybody.
Good job as usual. I'd like to shout out to Jerry Elizabeth. Thanks for looking in tonight. Mark Scanlon, we always appreciate you looking in. And David Lamas Andre, thank you for looking in on the Paul Santos Live Show tonight. We really appreciate it. By the way, for those of you who are watching this live, right? How about those Celtics right there? Huh? Let's hear it for the Celtics. You know, I got this as one of my Father's Day presents, so thanks to my wife for that. So I'll be putting this baby on after the show, and hopefully we can bring home a championship tonight. How about that? Huh? Wouldn't it be great? That'd be great. All right, our first guest tonight is really fantastic. She's a great singer. She sings a lot in Fall River, and she's actually singing a lot in Boston now, so her career is on the upswing. And after you hear her, you'll know why. Ladies and gentlemen, would you please welcome Emily Naraki? Hey!
How we doing tonight? I might need your help with this song. Don't worry, you'll know it. Hey, where did we go? Days when the rain came down in the hollow, playing a new game, laughing and a running, hey, hey, skipping and a jumping in the misty morning fog with our hearts thumping. You, cry, my girl. You my brown eyed girl. Whatever happened, Tuesdays are so slow. I'm going down and on my midday transistor radio. I'm standing in the sunlight laughing, high behind a rainbow's wall. Slipping and a sliding all along the waterfall with you, brown eyed girl. So hard to find my way now that I'm on my own. I saw you just the other day. My, you have grown. Cast my memory back there, Lord. Sometimes I overcome thinking about it. Making love in the green grass behind the stadium.
Your help, ready?
Do you remember when?
Can you sing with me?
We used to sing sha la 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 la.
Keep going.
Emily Naraki. Oh, that was just great. Welcome, Emily, to the Paul Santos Live Show. Grab a seat.
I'm so happy to be here once again. Thanks for having me.
Oh, that's great. You know, we had you on before, and we thought, oh, you were just great. We loved you, so we're happy
Thank
to have you.
You
back.
Thank you for having me.
Well, a lot has happened since the last time we spoke. Yeah. I know you've been in school and stuff like that. Are you still in school?
So I graduated undergrad, and I'm actually doing my master's. I'm completing it in 1 year. Next week, I'll be graduating with a master's in composition.
Wow, that's awesome. All right, and what school are you getting your master's in?
Berklee College of Music.
Berklee College of Music. Now, come on, man. Now listen, you know they don't just take anybody at Berklee College of
Music,
right?
The audition process is criminal. I mean, it's you know, one audition, then that's okay, then you go into the next audition. And once you're already in the school, you have to audition again because they put you in different music classes if you're more talented than someone else.
Wow. It's like the music version of the bar exam, right?
Exactly.
Like the kind of thing,
exactly.
Except it's music, right?
Yeah.
Nothing like it.
Yeah, it's the music is harder.
Yeah. I went to Berklee, and she's absolutely right.
Yeah.
I didn't go to law school, though.
Well, that's great. Good for you. So now, I understand that, you know, you posted this on social media. You play a lot in Fall River at that Pier 52.
Yeah, every Sunday, Pier 52. It's a beautiful venue. It's right on the water.
Yeah, yep. That's where I met. My wife and I went and saw you perform, and I told my wife, I got to go talk to her. So it worked out great. But now, you have a residency in Boston.
Yeah, I do. It's at Sam Adams Tap House. It's right in Faneuil Hall. It's the third Thursday of every month. It's my second Boston residency. I was at the Deck 12 in the Seaport last summer, so I'm moving over to Sam Adams. So.
All right, let's hear it. I mean, that's great. You know why? You know, being able to play in the big city like that, I mean, it's a little bit different. You meet a lot of people. You can make a lot of connections. So good for you.
Yeah.
What's it like playing in a big city like that?
They don't tip.
Oh, really?
No.
Come on, a big city like that where all the big shots are.
I get my most tips, believe it or not, in Fall River.
Fall River.
They appreciate the music there. That's for sure.
All right. Well, that's great. Well, hopefully New Bedford can kick in a little bit, too, you know.
Yeah.
But yeah, that's great. That Pier 52, beautiful, right on the water.
Yeah.
And what else you got going on? I mean, you just kind of, you know, been working and doing the gigs and all that. You have a lot of gigs, right?
I'm gigging 5 times a week, full time. I'm losing my voice. I'm teaching singing during the week, Monday through Thursday. I teach voice lessons and songwriting lessons, and I've got an album coming out.
Oh, that's great. That's awesome. I didn't know you were a voice coach.
I'm a voice coach. Now, this is a new thing.
You got to, you know, add something new to that tight schedule, right?
Yeah, it's tough because I sing all on the weekends and then I come into work and I can't sing. And my students will be like, oh, can you demonstrate? And I'm like, I have no voice.
Yeah, because you use it all.
Because I use it all, exactly.
All right, so now you're using it here tonight too, right?
Yes, yeah.
It's only two songs though, right?
Yeah, that's nothing. I do 4 hours most of the time. My gigs are 4 hours straight.
Wow,
yeah.
Wow. And you crazy. Don't take any breaks or anything?
I take a couple. Yeah. Sometimes I stretch it a little bit
that's
too.
That's awesome.
Yeah.
So now you have, what is it, one brother?
I have a brother, yes.
What's that like? Sometimes a brother-sister
Oh, my God. Growing up, since I could sing, my mom put me in voice lessons. I would practice. He'd cover his ears and scream. He's older than me, too. So, yeah.
So he gave you a hard time?
He gives me a hard time, yep.
And now you're older. You're going to be moving back home, right?
Oh, my God. Wish me luck. Once you get your first taste of freedom, right, it's going to be miserable.
So now you're going to go home and you got my house, my rules and all that
stuff? Oh, yeah. Huh? I have a curfew and I'm 23.
Oh, wow.
Am I right?
Well, it might be because you're a woman, too.
Yeah,
you know?
Could
I think there's
be
a little
that.
Bias there, right?
Yeah, right? Girl dad. Power.
Yeah. Yeah right. So you never had any issues with your mom? Because sometimes a mother-daughter can be
Mom is
about.
Great. She's my number one fan. She's here
tonight.
There
she is,
right
Mom.
I
ran away right there.
Me and my dad, we clash a lot. We have the same personality.
Oh.
So when things don't go our way and I'm sensitive, I just cry.
Oh.
There's nothing else I can do other than cry.
Oh.
Yeah.
So when you start crying, doesn't that like soften him up a little bit?
No, he yells more.
Oh, wow.
He yells more.
Ooh, wow.
Yeah.
Wow, that's a little difficult there.
Yeah, yeah.
But you don't do that. You don't. Yeah.
Sometimes it depends on what we're talking about, you know.
Well, that's great. Well, I'm glad to hear that the music is going so good.
Thank
and
you.
You're having so much fun. And I know when you're in school, what do you get A's in music, but some of the other subject not so much.
It's straight A's in music, but put me in a math class, I look like. Yeah.
Did you ever take algebra?
Oh, yeah. I get A plus what equals what squared. I have no idea. It wasn't for me. So they put me in music class, and I went to the best music school.
Nice, nice. Well, you know, real quick, this will only take 30 seconds, but I have to mention this. You know, as I became older, I'm fascinated with singers. I enjoy listening to singers. So I just started horsing around with, you know, taking some singing lessons and stuff
oh, geez.
Like that. And it's so much fun. And what you learn about the, you know, going up and down the scale and mm-hmm. the breathing and everything else, it's really fascinating. A lot more work, I think, than people think, you know?
Oh, yeah. It's definitely tough. And on top of just singing alone, there's so much things that especially you need to work on your posture, your diaphragm, your breathing. I took so many anatomy classes and you learn about your larynx and your pharynx. There's so many pieces to the puzzle that are so important when it comes to singing, especially doing it healthy when you're doing it as much as me, hours and hours a week. It's an instrument. You have to take care of it.
Yeah, absolutely. Wise men oh. say
a little sharp.
Only fools rush in.
Okay, beautiful vibrato.
But I can't help falling in love with you.
Beautiful. A plus.
They've made some progress.
Yeah, it was a little sharp.
We'll chop that up to the nerd.
Okay.
Yeah, yeah, I'm nervous up here singing with a professional. You know what I mean? Anyway, that was a lot of fun. So you got a second song queued
I
up
do.
Here?
Can I play it for you?
Yeah, that'd be great.
Absolutely.
All right, so
let's
we head
do
back
it.
To center stage. In the meantime, I'm going to say hello to some of our other fans over here. How about Lynn Marie Scrivano from, where's she from? Ah, yes, Niagara Falls, New York. She's always watching it every week. Thank you very much. Don St. John, thanks to him for looking in. Tasha Cogdell and Rick Levy. Looking in from the city of New York City. And Deb Ramis was a big fan of Casey, believe it or not. Thanks for looking in. William Shanks. Bruce Sear, too. Bruce Sear's a fan of Casey.
Is that Rooster you're talking about?
And right? William Shanks. All right. They're out there. You know, here and there, they're sprinkled around. All right, ladies and gentlemen, once again, Emily Naraki.
Let's do it.
Don't see better than I know myself, so I'm gonna let it do all the talking. Woo-hoo. I came across a place in the middle of nowhere with a big black horse and a cherry tree. Woo-hoo. I felt a little fear upon my back. I said, don't look back, just keep on walking. Woo-hoo. But a big black horse it looked this way. It said, hey, lady, will you marry me? Woo-hoo. Woo-hoo. But I said, no, no. No, 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 no. I said, no, no. You're not the one for me. No, no. No, 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 no. I said, no. You're not the one for me. So stop your dead for a beat or two. But I guess I'm calling, I shouldn't have done, and it won't forgive me after all these years. So I sent it to the place in the middle of nowhere with a big black horse and a cherry tree. Now I won't come back cause I'm so happy and I got a whole lot for the world. Yeah. But I said no, 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 no. I said no, you're not the one for me. No, 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 no. I said no, you're not the one for me. You're not the one for me. No, 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 no. Said you're not the one for me. Big black horse and a cherry tree, yeah. I can't quite get there cause my heart's forsaken me, yeah. Big black horse and a cherry tree, yeah. I can't quite get there cause my heart forsakens me. Oh, thank you so much. They emphasize that. Beautiful job. Thank you. That was awesome. God, I love playing music. Thanks for having me.
How about that? Emily and Araki.
Thanks, guys.
And how about the PSL band jumping awesome. Right in there? How about that, huh? Thanks a lot, Emily. All
thank
right,
you.
Stand by. We got comedy coming up next here on the Paul Santos Live Show. Please stay right where you are. That PSL band, they're bringing it tonight. PSL band, ladies and gentlemen, let's hear it.
Thank you, everybody, for clapping for us.
You know what? I think you guys are showing off tonight. You guys have been awesome, you know? Jumping right in there with Emily, that was great. And Artie with the sax and the keyboard. I just thought, wasn't that great the way they jumped in?
We're only as good as our guests. That's a fact. Don't ever forget that.
That's right, we are, we are. Well, speaking of, well, she's not really a guest because she's a regular, but we haven't seen her in a long time. So she feels kind of like a guest in a way. Welcome back our director of comedy, Allison Dyan. Yeah.
Thank you. Thank you.
Boy, did we miss you.
Yeah, we missed you, Allison.
Boy, I missed you guys, too.
Well, Johnny J did a hell of a job.
Yeah, Johnny J filling in. Let's hear it for Johnny J. Come on, come on, come on, come on, come on, come on.
He did great.
He doesn't look as good in heels as you do, though.
You know,
he tried it, but it didn't work.
He brings other things to the table. He did great.
Yeah, fantastic. Yeah. So now about you. I mean, you've been doing a little bit of traveling, right?
Yeah, I was on the West Coast. I was in Los Angeles and Tucson and Phoenix.
Wow, big time.
Yeah, it's so much fun.
A lot of time on the road, huh?
A lot of time on the road. Luckily, I have a husband who doesn't mind driving me everywhere, so it's great.
Yeah, it works out, huh?
Yeah, it works out. You know, he drives, I sleep, so it's good.
Oh, you get the chauffeur job, huh?
Yeah.
Wow. That's nice. That works
out
well.
Work.
So tell me about being on the road. Anything strange happen?
So I was, so one of the rare nights my husband took off from driving me around. I was driving around L.A. with a friend of mine, and we got a flat tire.
Oh, no.
And my friend is like one of these women who just likes to do everything herself. You know what I mean?
Yeah, right.
So, you know, we get a flat tire. I'm like, I'll call my husband, right? And she's like, no, Allison, we could do it ourselves. We're empowered. I'm like, okay, first of all, powerful women don't change their own tires. They don't, okay? Would Beyonce change her own tire? She would not change her own tire. Have you seen those weaves? She's wearing a $100,000 weave. Yeah. That's not even human hair. That is magical hair. It's grown by fairies in New Zealand somewhere. You think she's going to change a tire wearing that? I don't think so. No, she's not.
She's
not. Let me tell you, if Beyonce's car got a flat tire, she would not change it.
Right.
No, she would just buy a new Rolls Royce.
All you need to do is marry Jay-Z.
Exactly.
Right? Then I'd be all set, right?
Yeah, right?
That's the kind of empowered I want to be. I want to be the I'm going to buy a new Rolls Royce empowered, not the I'm going to change my own tire empowered.
Well, speaking of being empowered,
yes.
I think the next guest is kind of a powerful woman, isn't she?
She is.
In kind of her own way.
Yes, she's you're going to see.
Yeah, she's getting kind of on in years. I think she knows Casey, you know, from down in the... Where
the
Casey
retirement
lives.
Home?
Yeah, the retirement home. Let's find out. Say hello to the very funny Grace Whitestone.
Hey, everybody. How you doing? Yeah. All right. I just found two cheap, comfortable bras at Ocean State Job Lot. I'm ready to rock and roll. Actually, I just came from telling jokes at an assisted living facility. Don't knock it. The pay is good. I pretend the people are drooling over me. All the comedy events in assisted living are what they call BYOM. Bring your own medication. Do not touch mine either. I have to admit, it's kind of weird performing in assisted living compared to comedy clubs. For instance, it means something completely different when someone tells you to do them a solid.
Geez, that was good.
How come you're not telling your people are eating like when I say a joke?
Oh, don't steal that joke either.
I won't get any more graphic than that. I will say this, I'm glad that I'm still living independently, but my husband of many years just had a total knee replacement. What a big operation. He was like a newborn when I took him home from the hospital. I slept when he slept, and he took right away to the breastfeeding. I'm just kidding. The doctor said no breast milk, which is just as well because they don't have nursing bras at Ocean State Job Lot. I tell you, my knees are going, but I'm too afraid to have an operation. Everything drops as you get old. It's like I now have cellulite on my ankles, and that tramp stamp I got all those years ago, well, let's just say, right now, it kind of looks like it's getting sucked into a sinkhole. Yeah. Well, so I was helping my husband do his knee rehab operation, his knee rehab exercises. He was sitting in a chair in the living room. I'm on the floor with my legs spread apart. I know, really sexy. And my husband says to me, "I think I'm feeling some new sensations." And I said, "So am I. Your foot is in my crotch." I think we just invented toe blasting. Well, his surgeon was a female. She did tell him to wiggle his toes a lot. And now I have a foot fetish. As you can see. Before his during his rehab, I found my husband's 1980s porn stash. It really was the big hair decade. You know, and I didn't get mad. Sometimes when people haven't seen me for a while, they say, "Hey, is your ass disappearing?" And I always say, "No, I'm still married." Sorry, dear. But no, he's a good guy. He's right over there. Before his operation, my husband took me down to Outer Banks, North Carolina, to a place called Moorhead City. Oh, the power of suggestion. Oh, I have to tell you. But you know, I didn't realize North Carolina is the Bible Belt. Yep. I sneezed in our hotel lobby, and 5 different people blessed me. They wouldn't have done that if they knew what happened in Moorhead City. While we were away, I broke down and told my husband how much he meant to me. And it wasn't just the Chardonnay talking. That's because I was pounding Pinot Grigio. But my husband never wants to talk to me first thing in the morning unless it's about sports. You thought I was going to say sex, right? No. My husband is a Boston sports nut. And I really... Boston sports nut! Yep. I really wanted to get a tattoo of our anniversary. But I could picture him seeing it for the first time and going, "Sweetheart, do you realize on our wedding day, Nomar had 5 RBIs against the Yankees?" So you guys have been absolutely fantastic. It's great to be back here at Paul Santos. Enjoy the rest of the show.
Grace Whitestone.
Oh, my God.
You know, I always tell people this. Some people really fit into the show, but she really fits into the show, doesn't she?
Brilliantly.
It's because it's a nut house in here. That's why.
No, that brand of comedy, I just find that kind of
Thank
stuff hilarious.
Thank you so much.
You know
I
mean?
Work very hard on my baloney.
The thing about doing a solid.
It's a gentle poop joke. You know,
no, I understand. Yeah.
They told us in comedy school not to make the poop jokes, but I say, you know,
now this,
that's crap.
This elderly woman... This elderly woman persona, like, this is pretty good. How did this all come about?
Well, I'll just talk like myself for a moment.
This is Joanne Raposa.
I was
Joanne Raposa.
Thank you very much. Hold your applause.
Fabulous. I was here.
I look just like this, but I have brown hair. Yes. And I was here in January and had a great time. But I wanted to come back as my alter ego, Grace Whitestone. She sprung forth about 12 years ago. It was right after Phyllis Diller died. I got a message from above, put on a fright wig. No, I was working in New York City a lot, and I got advice from some people that were like deep in the industry. They said, "You have good jokes, but it doesn't match your appearance." So I thought, well, I'll just go whole hog old lady.
Well, it's kind of funny because it's interesting with comedy, right? The jokes that you were saying and the stuff that you were doing, it was funnier as this person right here, you know?
Grace gets bigger laughs than Joanna. She just does.
Well, you know, Rodney Dangerfield used to say that whole thing. Used to, "Oh, you know, my wife did that." Then he'd go backstage and he'd be talking like a regular person. That whole thing was a persona.
It's an act, people.
Yeah, it's an act. Yeah, right.
A lot of it is fake.
But it's a funny act.
That's the key.
Now, you live in this area here?
I live in Providence.
Providence, Rhode Island. All
Providence,
right.
Rhode Island. Woo!
ABC 6.
Yeah, there she is. There we go. Hey.
So you do a
lot
of
book me.
You do a lot of traveling around the area and stuff like that?
I do. I go
good for you.
I run a monthly show up near Boston and you know, so I'm all over New England, sometimes in New York City. Yep.
All right. Well, that's fantastic.
Thanks
Ladies
for having me back. What
put
a great
your
place.
Together for Joanna Raposa, a.k.a. Grace Whitestone.
Woo! Thank you, thank you, thank you.
We got a big-time actor coming up next. It's the Paul Santos Live Show. Please stay with us.
Thank you very much. That was fun.
That was great. Oh, no, you did, you did. Hey, Kevin Robinson is looking in tonight. Thank you very much for watching the show like you usually do. Ed Fernandez, Cecil Sassafras from Florida. What up? He's going to be on the show pretty soon. And as we mentioned, Lynn-Marie Scrivano from Niagara Falls absolutely loved Emily Naraki, the duet with, well, actually, she meant the duet. That must have been this thing, right?
Yeah, it was. Sure
Thank
was.
You very much. All right, we have a lot of stuff going on with the show tonight. I mean, we had a great singer. We had a great comedian. Now we have an actor. I mean, this guy's done a lot. He's been a producer. He's been a director. He's been an actor. And he's worked with some great actors like those who participated on The Sopranos. Ladies and gentlemen, put your hands together for Mr. Michael Hopkins.
How's everybody doing in the cheap seats back there?
Yeah.
You know, after that comedian, I'm wiggling my toes a lot. I don't know why.
You can practice that at home, you
it's
know?
It's good to be here, man. Thank you.
How you doing? Nice to see
you again. Little spoiler alert. About a month ago, Paul had the pleasure of coming to my house and do a little bit of a segment and a big program on that, which I was so honored for him to be a part of. Absolutely. Now I get to come to your house.
Yeah, thank you. That's awesome. That's awesome. And not to mention, it was like torrential rain and flooding.
Yeah,
and we still made it.
I ordered dry rain, but they sent us wet rain. What can you do, you know?
So, you know, you're an actor, and I know you've done a lot, and you've worked with some people, like some of those who participated in The Sopranos, like John Fiore and stuff like that. What's it like working with actors like that?
Oh, man, you know, it could be right down to the set designer. It's all about the people, you know, to work with those big names and to work with Federico Castelluccio, you know, who's you know, played Furio with on The Sopranos. You know, it's kind of surreal, you know, when they come on set, like everybody just kind of watches and they're doing a scene and he's acting and it's like he's doing three or four takes and he's like, oh, I want to do it better. And it's, everybody's soaking in all the knowledge. They're
right.
like,
so you're learning from him, right?
Learning from him, learning from the masters of the craft. There's no better gift than that. There's no better gift to be able to learn from even the set designers or the costume people or
right.
people that are just their first time and they're trying to make a name for themselves.
How long have you been an actor?
I've been acting since I was about 10 years old. I did a lot of plays.
Yeah, right.
And then I just got into movies recently. So it's been really great, really an honor to work with such wonderful people. I got some actors here that have come out to support you and the show and, you know, come out to see me as well. We got Romeo over here.
Thank you for coming. The actors table good. Over here. Let's hear it for the actors table.
So... got a good friend of mine and his wife who also is going to be in the film that we're doing.
Yeah, what's the film that you're doing?
It's called Death Comes Calling.
Death Comes Calling.
So it's a horror film.
Ooh,
it's gonna
I'm getting a tingly feeling already. Can you do that?
It's going to be filmed in Rhode Island and Massachusetts, primarily in Massachusetts.
Right, right. So. And what do you play in the movie?
I'm actually playing a private eye. So.
Wow.
I'm in a lot of the film as, you know, contrary to the previous film that the director of this new film, Stu Replogo, did called The Family's Feud. I played a hillbilly. In this film, I actually play a private eye, so it's different, totally different contrast to characters.
Well, I love that because, you know, when you think of a great actor, right, I think of, like, the actor that played the Fonz, right?
Let me know when you find
one. Nothing like,
you
know, no, but in real life, he's nothing like the character, you know?
Yes.
He played this tough guy, but in real life, he was kind of a laid-back, kind of a quiet guy. So you mean to tell me in one film you're playing a hillbilly, you know, kind of like a hillbilly, you know, the Mississippi and all this kind of stuff. And then all of a sudden you're a private eye, right? Yeah. That's a big difference between those two.
Language change, character change, movement change. Everything you say and do is different, you know?
How does the hillbilly sound?
Oh, well, y'all come back now, y'all. You know, you know, I haven't done the movie in a while, but I kind of get into the character and then get out of the character.
Yeah,
you know
right,
what I mean? But it's very much different when you go from one person. You live that character every day of your life until the shoot's over.
Right.
And then just like that, you go back to your normal self.
That's fantastic.
It's unbelievable.
That's fantastic. So tell me about the craft of acting. What is it? Like, how do you get yourself deep into that character to be able to perform that character and actually be that character? How do you do it?
Well, I think you have to have a good script. And Stu Replogo, I'm very fortunate of being on his first movie and now this movie. You have to have good writing. Good writing is key to everything. And then good supporting people. I mean, you can get on sets where everybody you work with is a douche, and you don't get along with them. It's true. They're pricks. What can you do? But
that's
how it happens. And then you could get on sets where, you know, it's your first time and you're nervous, and somebody like Stu Replogo takes you under his wing and says, this is what I want you to do. Don't worry about it. This is how you do it. So reading the script, memorizing the script, getting into your characterization, and having good people around you.
Right, that is
the key to the success is having people that are caring. You need the guy that can yell at you, but you need the guy that can nurture you too.
Right.
You need every part of it to be better and to perfect your craft.
You know what I always find interesting is when somebody's an actor, and even like Al Pacino or somebody like that, like in real life, like, you know, I wouldn't hurt a fly, right? But like if I was in a movie, I'd love to play like the killer. You know what I mean? So do you ever have
Paul
that
Santo
opportunity?
Shooting everybody up. Yeah, that'll sell.
That's going viral. Yeah,
yeah, that's going viral.
But to be able to take your own personality and put it aside for the character, that must be the fun part about it.
Oh, it's absolutely one of the most selfish, and really it is one of the most selfish platforms you could ever be on. You know, to be an actor, to put yourself into that role is just fantastic, you know. And it's also selfless because you get to help other actors become better. If you give your heart into something, whatever you do in life, people notice that. And then if you know, on the basketball court, anywhere in the world, anywhere you put your heart into, people are going to see that.
Right.
And sometimes that brings something out in someone. So you can act for yourself and be selfless, you know, go through my lines. Or you can act with the interpretation that you're going to make that other person better.
Right.
And you're going to do what's right for you and that other actor.
Gee, that's great. That's great. Well, you know, I know you're going to be doing this film in Massachusetts. You invited me to come up and maybe spend a day on the set. I really like to do that because I really find it fascinating when you see what goes on like behind the scenes. You know, like as you can see, we had a little problem here with the speaker until about 5 minutes before the show. But then our crackerjack guy, Aaron, he figured it out. We had a little...
The crackerjack guy.
Yeah, the crackerjack... the crackerjack audio guy. He figured it out, and we fixed it at the last minute. So things go wrong, and you have to kind of roll with the punches, right? Have you ever been on a situation where, you know, things were not happening too well?
Absolutely. You know, you get on plays. When I did plays when I was younger, there was many opportunities where things just don't go as planned.
Yeah.
And, you know, sometimes, especially the first two times you're doing the play, your first runs, audiences, there's people that forget whole lines, there's people that forget, you know, that missed their cues completely. I've done it. I know other people that have done it. So.
I think I'd forget my lines. I don't think I'd be good
all
at it.
The time.
I think I would
all
forget. My, yeah, like I need a cue card to be able to, you know, read something off. You know what I mean? Put it there, I'll read it. But as far as like trying to memorize it, I think I would have a hard time. You know?
Yeah, that's the whole thing. Is it's all memorization. It's always talking it through. You know, I tend to I read the lines really fast.
Yeah.
And that helps me. I can slow it down and helps me perform the scene better.
Yeah, yeah, right. You didn't have any problems with like memorizing the lines or anything like that?
Sometimes, yeah, you do. If it's a complicated scene or if it's a, you know, especially when you're doing plays, sometimes you have a long monologue and it just takes you forever. But once you get it down, you know you're going to be doing that every night. What I was surprised is when you're doing a movie, you could film your first scene last or your last scene first. So it changes everything. The plays are totally different than film. I love film a whole lot better. It keeps me surprised and suspense every day, so it's really cool.
You come here today on the day of my daughter's wedding.
The Godfather.
And you ask me to do you a favor. I do you a favor, you do me a favor. Why? Why do you come on the day of my daughter's wedding? Why do I come?
That's a classic. That's one of the best. I have nothing to say to that because I was perfectly done.
I'm sorry, I couldn't help it. Thank you for helping me with the music. I appreciate it. So when does the shoot start for this great film?
So we're shooting in August, and we're going to be shooting in October. So we got two, I think we're doing 5 days in October and 7 days in August, if I'm not correct. Stu will probably kill me, I get that wrong. But I think it's a longer shoot in August for sure. So right. We're going to be up in Massachusetts. We got some great locations.
That's gonna be fun.
Well, Stu Rep Logal, you know, you can be an artist at things, right? You can be a painter, you can be a plumber, you can be anybody can be an artist. But Stu's art is film, and he's about to paint his masterpiece.
Right.
I mean, we've gone through so many locations, we've gone through many actors and actresses changes, and he stayed right there working 12, 13 hours tirelessly on this project. To make sure that we all get right. So he's a good leader, and we're really excited about bringing it to the world. We're actually going to have a fundraiser soon.
Let me know.
You know, and we'd like to maybe put that on here if possible
at some point.
Absolutely. But we'd like to try to get as much money as possible. You know, we like to service a lot of the actors and actresses and people that let us use their houses and their homes and stuff. We like to try to compensate them, and it'll help us put out a better movie. So. Eventually, at some point, it's going to be a really cool horror movie. It's local. We have a lot of local people on board. We have a great cast and crew.
I like this whole horror genre. That's going to be fun, you know?
Very different. Yeah, it's going to be really cool. We're really excited about it.
We really appreciate you coming down. All the best with the shoot, and will you come visit us again?
Yes. Can I just say one more thing before we cut off?
I
want to share this with the world. I'm an actor, so there's one thing that, you know, is very important to me is the sheer film and the sheer films that have impacted me in my life. So people ask me, what are my influences? And they are film. So this movie is called The Cure. You're not going to find it. You can't stream it anywhere. But it's one of the greatest films ever made. So if you ever get a chance to step back and watch it, watch it. It's the best movie about friendship ever made. I'm also going to give one to all your crew, a copy of this.
Thank you very much.
And because, you know, you invited me into your home, this was signed by Tony Sirico of The Sopranos.
Oh, wow.
It's a very, very rare Sopranos wine. I'd like you to have it and say thank you so much.
Thank you so much. All right.
On the show. Thank you, everybody.
Thank you very much.
And remember, keep wiggling your toes.
Michael Hopkins, thank you very much. We'll be right back. Let's turn it over to Gary and Artie for a little ditty here on the Paul Santos Live Show.
Look at me, I'm as helpless as a kitten up a tree, and I feel like I'm clinging to a cloud I can't understand. I get misty just holding your hand. Walk my way, and 1,000 violins begin to play, or it might be the sound of your hello. That music I hear, I get misty the moment you're near. You can say that you're leading me on, but it's just what I wanted you to do. Don't you notice how hopelessly I'm lost? That's why I'm following you. On my own, what I wander through this wonderland alone, I never know when my right foot from my left, my hat from my glove. I'm too misty and too much in love.
Ladies and gentlemen, let me introduce Mr. Artie DeMello, my left-hand man. Artie DeMello, everybody, give him some love.
About the PSL band.
Thank you, Paul. Thank you, everybody.
Well, we're getting ready to wind things down here on the Paul Santos Live Show. It's been a great show. We've had a little bit of everything, and what's that? What do you mean we have another guest? You got to be kidding me. I didn't think we had time tonight. What are you talking about? Crazy Casey!
I bought this for your wife.
Oh, the Celtics are going to win the championship tonight.
I hope so.
Hey, I like that shirt. Where'd you get that?
I had this shirt when I actually asked my wife to marry her. This shirt is 55 years old.
Nice, nice.
I met my wife in a banana grove in South America.
Didn't it come with like a theme song or something?
At night, it was dark, and she made a bad mistake, and she thought I was the best thing in the world.
Wow.
So I'm Chiquita Banana's wife. Remember her, Carmen Miranda? She used to wear fruit in her head. My wife had fruit in her head.
I'm a Chiquita Banana, and I'm here to say... I'm the top banana in the world today.
That's it.
That? Yeah, I remember that. Yeah.
Chiquita Banana. My father always said, if you want to be a top banana on the Paul Santos Show, wear a stupid shirt. I you want it, I'll give it to you.
Those bananas, they're very, very, very fascinating.
This shirt comes with about $4,000 a month in alimony payments. Hey, how was your Father's Day?
Very nice, yeah.
I have to say, I paid a compliment to your wife. You have two beautiful sons.
Thank you, thank you.
And I know how much you love them. And they are very handsome. And I just wondered how the hell she got around you. Christ. She's got two beautiful sons, and he looks like Pee Wee Herman. But anyway. How was your Father's Day? Mine was wonderful.
It was excellent, excellent.
I had my three children. The thing that bothers me about Father's Day is... I get all these cards from people and boys and daughters and things. I don't know them from different parts of the world. But now I realize, because I went to Walmart, now they sell Father's Day cards in packs of 10. They put out by Maury Povich. Yes, you are the father.
Who's your vavoo? Who's your vavoo?
Yeah, who's your mama? Anyway, I ran into a friend of mine. You were talking about the new rooster.
Yeah, the new rooster. That's true. There's going to be a big rooster in downtown New Bedford.
Has anybody seen the new rooster, really?
Yeah.
Well, it is. And you know, one thing is, it's the first time in the city we've got a cock bigger than everybody in office.
Hello, amigo.
And you know, I don't like to correct you, because I know you do your own editing, but I will tell you this. When those whalemen came in from the whaling shipping of a year, ventures of a year, and they were all over the country, everywhere in the world, bringing whale blubber in here.
Sundowning.
Those widow's walks and everything, they were on every building downtown. And it wasn't a, what did you call it, a cock a what? Cock a doodle doo?
Cock a doodle doo.
No, it's a cock a two will do.
Yeah.
All right, ladies and gentlemen.
I'm so happy to see you. I just want everybody to know I was engaged to somebody and I broke it off, but I ran into a very, very prominent lawyer who told me he married a beautiful, young, virgin 3 years ago.
Yeah.
Said if she's still a virgin on her anniversary, he's going to throw her out.
Raising Casey, ladies and gentlemen.
Daddy.
Wow.
If
I can help the neighbor, call the thing. Look at that dance by Gary over there. Look at that. What is that?
That's the Chiquita Banana song, man.
Yeah, I love that. Wow.
Big Daddy's Banana.
Wow, how did you find that? You Googled it, right?
I have exclusive rights to it, Paul.
My goodness.
I have exclusive rights to it. Only I can play that song. Only me.
All right. Well, shout out to Kelly Cavano. She's going to be on the show in a little while with another gentleman, and it'll be a fun night, Justin Moniz. So we're looking forward to that. But for right now, we have to thank our guest. How about the sensational Emily Naraki? Thank you so much for being on the show tonight. And Joanne Raposa as Great Whitstone. And how about that fantastic actor, Michael Hopkins? Our thanks to Crazy Casey. Comedy director, Allison Dian. Our floor director, Rockin' Randy. And a producer director, documentary filmmaker, and award-winning one from Bristol County Media, Mr. Aaron Cadju. Next week, we have a great show. Well, it's not next week. It's 2 weeks, okay? We're not going to be here next week, but in 2 weeks, we'll be back for another edition of the Paul Santos Live Show. A fantastic singer will be here, Tracy Fonz, a person who deals with the beyond. You know, he tries to talk to people that are dead and stuff like that. Bruce Duart and the serial entrepreneur, we love her, Jen Parter. That'll be 2 weeks right here at Mikey B's. Thank you very much for all of you folks for being a fantastic live studio audience. And for those of you who are watching on television or on live stream, if you want to see a live taping of the Paul Santos Live Show, we're here just about every Monday. We have a few that we're not, but we're just about here every Monday, 7 p.m. at Mikey B's, 989 Victoria Street here in New Bedford. For the PSL band, there they are. I'm Paul Santos. Don't forget to laugh. We'll see you next time.
Wake up with a clock. How far behind me? Which rubbles melt like lemon drops away above the chimney tops? That's where you'll find me. Somewhere the rainbow, bluebirds fly, yeah, birds fly over the rainbow, why, little white.